following message was recorded at The Way. For additional messages and information, log on to our website, www.thewaycolumbus.com, or email us at thewaycolumbus@gmail.com. Now, get ready to hear a word from God.
Ecclesiastes, it's in the Old Testament, is what I'm going to use as a foundational text, and I'm not going to talk about it right now. We'll get to it before I'm done, but I want to read it up front. Ecclesiastes chapter 4, starting at verse 9. Ecclesiastes 4, verse 9. I'm going to read out of the New Living Translation. You can follow along in whatever you got. Ecclesiastes. I'm going to give you just a couple more seconds, because how many of you don't read Ecclesiastes on a regular basis? Amen. Hands went up everywhere. Yes. Like, where is it, Lord? It's in the Old Testament. It's not real long, so you might pass it a couple times before you find it. Them old school ugly Bibles work. The old school ugly Bibles with the tabs, that came in handy. Everything is cute now. You can't find nothing. You know, I need an old school Bible with them tabs on the side that they used to have. It's not cute, but it'll help you in a pinch when you get called to turn to Habakkuk or Ecclesiastes or something like that. All right? If you have it, say, I have it. Now, I haven't preached in a while, so I hope y'all not going to make me work today too hard. Can somebody say amen?
Amen?
Can somebody say preach, Pastor Shawn?
Preach, Pastor Shawn.
If you do that, I'll get you out of here in 30 minutes. You believe it?
No.
Right, because y'all not very vocal, so yeah, it may not happen. But if you push me, if you push me, I'll get you out of here early. I really have a short message. This is just the foundation of my series, so it's not long. I'm going to read Ecclesiastes 4, starting at verse 9. Two people are better off than one, for they can help each other succeed. If one person falls, the other can reach out and help. But someone who falls alone is in real trouble. Likewise, two people lying close together can keep each other warm. Spooning, amen. I wouldn't encourage that unless you're in a dire situation and it's not your, you know, particularly guys, you know, we don't. But I'm sure in a survival mode in a foxhole, guys might consider spooning. But anyway, body heat. But how can one be warm alone? A person standing alone can be attacked and defeated. But two can stand back to back and conquer. Three are even better, for a triple braided cord is not easily broken. So far, the reading of the scripture. And I'm going to give you my series title, and then I'm going to give you my sermon topic. All right? Here's the series title for those of you that are taking notes: How to Make Friends and Influence People for the Kingdom of God. How to make friends, how to win friends, and influence people for the Kingdom of God. How to win friends and influence people for the Kingdom of God. And my subject today is defining friendship God's way. Defining friendship God's way. If you don't get this, none of the rest of the series will make sense. Can we pray?
Yes.
Father, we come to you in Jesus' name, and we thank you for who you are. We thank you that you're God all by yourself, and beside you, there's nothing else. We thank you, O God, that you chose to send your Son and to save us, though we didn't deserve it. We thank you that you're just that good of a Father, that you would reach out and save us when we were fallen in sin, when we had fallen in the mud of our mistake, when we were suffering from the consequences of our disobedience. You reached out for your children. You had a plan to redeem us all along. And Father, we thank you for that. I ask you, God, that you would speak to your people, that they would not hear me, but that they would only hear you. And Father, we give you praise for what will be said and done in our midst today. In Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen. Let's get to work. Man was created for relationship. How many of you know that? Man was created for relationship, connectivity, community. This is why man was created. God did not simply create a man and leave him on this planet by himself with nothing that he could connect to or relate to. Man looked at the cow, but he couldn't connect with the cow. Man looked at the fish, and though he admired the fish's beauty and he admired the fish's ability to swim underwater, he could not connect or relate to the fish. He looked at all of God's creation and he couldn't find anything that looked like him. And God, in his divine sovereignty, looked at man and said, it's not good. It's not good for man to be alone. And so he created for man a suitable helper. Now, oftentimes when we read this text, we only think of connectivity in the sense of marriage. But how many of you know the greatest level of connectivity in a marriage is friendship? Friendship. Because it does no good to be married to somebody you can sleep with but you don't like. Y'all don't hear what I'm saying. It does no good to be married with someone that you don't have any commonalities with and any common goals with. Friendship, I will submit to you today, is the foundation of all other relationships that we have in this world today. Friendship is critical to connectivity. It is critical to relationship. It is critical to community. Everybody say community.
Yes.
Community, community. Science has proven the need for connectivity because if a baby is born and it is divorced of connectivity, of touch, of relationship, though you feed it, though you clothe it, though it's in a warm environment, that child will die. That is how serious our need as human beings for connectivity is. Away with the notion that you don't need anybody but God. Away with the notion that all I need, just give me a husband and give me a wife and that's all I need. How many of you know that even in the confines of marriage, you still need some friends? Oh, y'all don't hear what I'm saying. See, we can't be that kind of spouse that is insecure about our spouse having relationships outside of us. Because if our spouse has relationships outside of us, it will cause them to be emotionally healthy. And it will cause them to have outlets outside of you. So that when you get them, when they come back from hanging out with their boys, they're a better husband. Y'all don't hear what I'm saying. When they come back from the girls' night out, they're a better mother and a better wife. Friendship is important. Connectivity is important. connection is important to every person's personal development. The Bible, believe it or not, talks about this particular connection that I want to discuss today, which is called friendship. How many of you have a friend? How many of you have needed a friend and didn't have one to call on? I know I have. Friendship is important. The Bible talks about it. How many of you know that anything the Bible talks about is important for you to know?
Yes.
Come on. If God took the time and all of the many concepts and ideas that he allowed to be expressed in the scriptures, if he allowed the subject of friendship to be discussed over and over and over again, then friendship must be important to God. If something is important to God and we are followers of the Lord Jesus Christ, how many of you know what's important to him should be important to us? Should be important to us. There should be nothing that God deems important that we say is unimportant. So let's define the word friend. I have three definitions that I want to read that I got out of the Webster's Dictionary. The word friend is defined attached, one attached to another by affection or esteem. Here's a good one. One that is not hostile. Somebody say a friend. And number three, a favored companion. So we want to think in terms of that a friend, simply defined, is one who is attached to another by affection or by esteem. One that is not hostile. In other words, you can't continually be mean to me and call me your friend.
Right.
Oh, y'all don't hear what I'm saying. Oh, I got friends, yet you mean.
Right.
Come on. You can't call me a friend and treat me like trash.
Right.
Oh, I'm helping somebody today already. Because some of you have called people friends that aren't friends and cut off people that were friends. A favored companion. Obviously, friendship is important because the Father deems it important. Imagine God calling a man his friend. Out of all of the terminologies, son of God, servant of God, he calls those who serve him friends. Look at somebody and say, I'm a friend of God. I'm a friend of God. I'm one God is attached to by affection. What does that mean? When God calls me a friend, God says, I'm affectionate concerning you. He says, I esteem you. Oh, what do you mean God esteems you? What is man that thou art mindful of him? Or the son of man that thou visit. You've made him in the HVSC a little lower than yourself. He looked to create man and he said, let us make man in our image and in our likeness. And let them have dominion. It says to me that God thinks some kind of way about us. Oh, it's important to know. Not only does God call us friends, but Jesus calls us friends. Because Jesus says, if you do what I command of you, you are my friend. You're my friend. Friendship is important to God. The concept of friendship is not below sonship. Come on. The concept of friendship is not below family. Y'all don't hear what I'm saying. See, many of us have minimized this concept of friendship as not being as important as other levels or layers of relationship. But the Bible teaches us that friendship is important.
Oh, God.
is something you got to understand. For what you do not understand, you abuse. Anything, if I don't understand the use of a thing, I'm going to misuse it. If I need the hammer in a nail, I'm not going to take the keyboard and use it to hit a nail, because that's not what it was created for. That's not what its purpose and intent is. If I don't understand that, then I will abuse the keyboard. Many of us are abusing the relationships in our lives because we don't understand their purpose. And we don't understand their importance. Somebody say purpose and importance. It's important. The challenge we face is that most people don't know what real friendship looks like. See, you got to understand that we're born in sin and we're shaping in iniquity. You got to understand that our minds have been fashioned by the teaching and the dictates of this carnal world. This is why the Bible teaches us in Romans chapter 12, be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. See, God doesn't just want to renew your mind in the area of giving. God doesn't just want to renew your mind in the area of your sexual behavior. God doesn't just want to renew your mind in the area of your marital relationship or your parental relationship. But God wants to renew your mind in every single area of your life. If it's in the Bible, it's important to God.
Yes.
So many of us work out friendship carnally.
Take your time.
We work out friendship carnally. We learned bad habits.
Yes.
We've had bad models about what friendship looks like. And how to choose friends, and how to hold on to friends, and what is friendship versus what is not friendship. If y'all help me, I'll preach. I told you, if you help me, I'll work and I'll get you out of here. Come on, somebody say preach, Pastor Shawn. Thank you. Y'all want to get out of here today. We usually pick friends from a carnal standpoint and for all the wrong reasons. Oh, God. Y'all don't hear what I'm saying. I said we pick friends from a carnal standpoint and for all the wrong reasons. I'm trying to tell you how to win friends and influence people for the kingdom of God. You got to do it God's way.
Yes.
See, until... Help me, Holy Ghost. Until you learn that everything that you've learned to count it as dung, you can't have the excellency of Christ. What does that mean? Paul said, I've learned how to count everything that I think I know and everything that I've learned and everything that I've experienced as doo-doo. It is not comparable to the excellency of the knowledge of Jesus. Come on now. Come on. He says, that's how much what I think I know is worth. And until you come to the place where you stop worshiping at the shrine of your own ideas, when you stop worshiping at the shrine of your own concepts, when you stop bowing down at what you think and admit to God, I don't know nothing if you don't teach me something. You can't begin to grow in God. I think I'll preach while I'm here. I feel like it. You won't learn anything. And the reason why many of us are not growing in God is because we think we know something.
Yeah.
We think we know who to be with. We think we know who should be our friends. We think we know what career path we should take. We think we know who we should marry. We think we know where we should live. We think, y'all don't hear what I'm saying. We think we know what church we should belong to. We think we know everything. But you got to learn how to count it as dung so that you can obtain the more excellent knowledge. And that comes through Jesus, oh God, that comes through Jesus Christ. You don't start growing till you admit I'm stupid. You don't start learning till you admit that, yes, I may have obtained worldly wisdom. Yes, I may have obtained some mama ease and some sister ease, but I don't know anything. God, I'm empty. You fill me up and tell me how this thing works. So we approach friendship from a carnal standpoint, a worldly standpoint, and for all of the wrong reasons. Many of us are a product of the friends we've surrounded ourselves with. Oh, y'all don't hear what I'm saying? Your life is a product of who you run with.
My God.
Because who you run with, you listen to. Who you run with, they influence. You don't hear what I'm saying. Who you run with, come on. How many of you remember being a teenager and getting in trouble because all of the kids you ran with were troublemakers? They flock together and water seeks its own level. Mm-hmm. You're a product. We're a product. And even when you become an adult, you're a product of who you surround yourself with. If you surround yourself with people who ain't about nothing, who don't have no goals, who don't have no ambitions, who doesn't have any dreams, guess what? You're not going to have none either. Mm-hmm. Because they don't want to start a business and they don't mind being on welfare and they don't mind. You settle in to what you think is normalcy. But let me tell you something. When you get ready to grow, you got to shake off old friends and old entanglements and find some people who are going where you're trying to go and doing what you want to be doing and living like you want to live. Come on. You got to put down pride, because sometimes we don't deal with people who aren't on the level we're on because we don't want to feel bad about ourselves. But that's dung mentality. That's doo-doo mentality. Real mentality says, you know what? You may have more than me. Your house may be nicer, but I'm coming over because I want to see how you got here, because I'm not trying to live like this the rest of my life. Friends. Amen. I'm doing the best I can. The Bible says in Proverbs 22, verse 24, keep away from angry. For those of you who think the Bible don't say that, yes, it does. Keep away from angry, short-tempered people, or you will learn to be like them and endanger your soul. So that's what God is saying. He says, if you surround yourself around people who can't keep their mouth shut and people who have an anger problem and a temper problem, it will produce that in you. So who you befriend is important to your life, and it's important to your walk with God. This is why when God saves us, he says, come out from among them and be ye separated, saith the Lord. What that means is that you can't be friends with the world and be friends with God. For either the world is going to influence, y'all don't hear what I'm saying, and pull you away from God, or God is going to influence you and pull you away from the world. Some of us are weak because we won't come out from among them. Come on. Some of us are struggling in our walk because we won't come out from among them. I'm talking about friendship. Some of us can't go to the next level because we won't get around people who are at the level I want to be at. We can't get around people who are pray like I want to pray, who study the word like I want to study, who treat people the way I want to treat people. We surround ourselves with people who still kicking it. People who still shiesty. People who still lie. People who are still cheaters. Come on. People who encourage you to do things that are not of God because they are still being governed by the God of this world. See, when you hang out with unbelievers, you're hanging out with people who are serving a different God and a different master. Who you gonna let influence you? It's wherever you put your time.
Yes.
It's wherever you put your energy. Come on.
Yes.
All right, y'all stay with me. I'm still in my introduction, but I'm moving. Let's examine the Bible's wisdom on this subject. I have three main points, and then I'm going to tie it up with Ecclesiastes, and then I'm done. My first point is concerning defining friendship God's way, is a true friend will tell you the truth. I'm talking about a true friend. You got to be careful when you surround yourself with yes men. It's a sure sign that disaster is on the horizon. Should I buy this? Yes, yes, yes. Should I go here? Yes, yes, yes. Should I smack them? Yes, yes, yes. Come on. Y'all laughing, but the truth be told, on a more granular level, most of us don't like people in our lives who tell us anything other than yes. We look for people to agree with us. In our mind, in the carnal mind, that is the definition of what a friend is. Come on. A friend agrees with you. A friend sees it your way. Come on. A friend never questions what you're doing or the validity of it. But the Bible doesn't teach that's what a friend is. A friend will tell you the truth. I think some of us have had some real friends in our lives and we've aborted those friendships because our thinking was carnal. Proverbs 27, 5 and 6 says, an open rebuke is better than hidden love. Wounds from a sincere friend are better than the kisses from an enemy. Oh, that preaches all by itself. That means somebody who will tell me the truth say, nah, you wrong. Nah, you handled that wrong. No, you shouldn't have said that. That person is not your enemy. God help me. I said that person is not your enemy. That person is your friend. This is what the Bible says. Will we continue to worship at the shrine of our emotions? And what feels good? Or will we align ourselves up with the Word of God and says, okay, God, help me to see the people that you sent into my life to help me get to the next level. Help me see them. My God, I feel like preaching. I said, help me see them. Oh, Detroit, I'm on the way. I said, help me see them. Help me see them. In other words, a friend will not always agree or tell you what you want to hear. What if you're wrong? Have you ever considered that? What if you're wrong? What if what you're about to do is actually the bad decision? And because God doesn't send it wrapped in the package that you want. See, that's the problem. Some of us want God to do everything supernaturally. Well, the Lord, if the Lord will speak to me, the Lord spoke to you. He sent you a friend. He sent you somebody who's a friend to tell you, nah, girl, don't do that. Da, 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 da. And you shut it down.
My goodness.
Oh, God. How many mistakes have we made? How many messes have we got into? And then we were upset like, God, why didn't you stop me? God, come on now. And you look back. I want you to look back, because I guarantee you, God sent somebody to say, don't do it.
Man.
He sent you a friend. A true friend will tell you what you need to hear. Not because they hate you, but because they love you. Oh, God is trying to help us in the area of relationships, because a lot of the things we take offense over is actually love and not the other way around. Oh, God. People leave churches because somebody didn't agree with them. People break up with people and get divorces because somebody told them something that they did not want. Y'all don't hear what I'm saying. You got people who has nobody that's been in their life all of their life because they disconnect from people the moment people aren't agreeing with the path that they've chosen. Number two. A real friend makes you better. A real friend makes you better. Proverbs 27 and 17. As iron sharpens iron, so a friend sharpens a friend. God help me. God give us some real friends. God help us see the real friends you sent. Some of us, we do need some real friends. And some of us need to just open your eyes and see the friends God has already sent you. In other words, a godly and true friend always adds to you. They make you wiser. They push you to go further and be better. They only want to see you succeed and be the best you can be. Oh, God. A real friend sharpens you. How many of you know that you can't be sharpened without friction? When you look at the sharpening process, if you've ever seen a blade sharpened or an iron sharpened, it's sharpened with another piece of material that's not made or composed of the same composition that the item being sharpened is made of. What does this mean, Pastor Shawn? I'm glad that you asked me. It means that not all of your friends will look like you. Y'all don't hear what I'm saying. Not all of your friends will think like you. Not all of your friends will approach life the way that you approach it. See, some of us have siloed ourselves, and that's why we don't grow. Some of us only gravitate to people who think like we think, who talk like we talk, who look like we look. Come on, somebody. Come on. That's why some of us have no culture, because we won't befriend anyone who don't eat soul food. We won't befriend anyone who won't eat chicken. Y'all don't hear what I'm saying. Oh, I can't go to dinner with her because she eats funny. Honey, grow. Let yourself be sharpened. Realize that the world is bigger than your little two blocks. I'm moving. Number three. A good friend is not selfish, but sacrifices for their friend. The Bible teaches us to prefer one another. Oh. I said the Bible teaches us to prefer one another. How in the world can we reach a lost and dying world if we don't prefer anyone above ourselves? See, if you don't prefer anyone above yourself, you're not going to go out of your way. Y'all don't hear what I'm saying? Because your agenda is always going to take center stage. Come on. Your needs are always going to take center stage. Your comfort is always going to take center stage. But when you come into the kingdom of God, it's not about you. I want you to touch three people and tell them it's not about you. It's not about you. Give it up. Let it go. It's not about you. When you get that through your head, God will be able to use you. When you get that through your head, doors will begin to be open. When you get that, y'all don't hear what I'm saying. When it's not about you, then God will really be able to use you. Don't ask God to use you. But God, you can only use me on Thursdays. God, I want you to use me, but I'm only free on Monday nights from 7. Y'all don't hear what I'm saying. Real friends, good friends, are not selfish, but sacrifice for their friend. John 15 and 13, greater love has no man than this, that someone laid down his life for his friend. Jesus said this and then modeled it. He says, I'm going to show you what a good friend I am. Oh, my God. I'm going to show you what real friendship looks like. Oh, come on. Y'all don't hear what I'm saying. He says, I'm going to show you that because you're my friend, that is the reason I'm going to sacrifice my life for yours. See, there's no greater love. He didn't say than a husband lay down his life. He didn't say that a father lay down his life. He said that a friend. What does that say? The love of a friend is just like that of someone who you are blood with.
Right.
See, God has to teach us this principle because some of us have issues coming into the body of Christ and loving like we love people who are our blood, because we say, well, you ain't my blood and you ain't my daddy and you ain't my sister. The devil is a lie. We are brothers and sisters in Christ and we should be friends. And it's no diminishing of love. And it's no diminishing of care. Jonathan and David had this kind of relationship where they said that their love for each other was so strong that it was even stronger than the love of a woman. Come on. It wasn't nothing gay. Come on. I said it wasn't nothing gay. Because when you understand what true love looks like, you take the perversion out of it. Come on. Some of us, it's carnal thinking. It's carnal thinking. You listen, see, Pastor Kendall and I love you, but we don't want to sleep with you. Y'all don't hear what I'm saying. I said, Pastor Kendall and I love you. I mean, love you. But honey, it's not that we want to get in your bed. See, we got to take the carnality out of love. Love ain't about sex, honey. Y'all don't hear what I'm saying. See, this is how God is trying to teach us to love in the body of Christ, so we won't be so skeptical of everybody, so that we don't think that just because somebody shows us a little attention that they want something. Not in the kingdom. Not in the kingdom. Not in the kingdom. Greater love have no man than this. Then a man laid down his life for his friends. I'm coming to a close. Let's look at Ecclesiastes. What is God trying to say in my conclusion? Two people are better off than one, for they can help each other succeed. My God, how much further might you go if you let God bring a real friend into your life? That don't act like you, look like you, think like you, do the things you do, go the places you go. What's the problem with befriending someone who's more spiritually mature than you? What would happen to your spiritual life if you stop hanging out with people who don't know your God, love your God, think about your God, trying to serve your God? How much more spiritual might you be? How much more battles might you win if you could call someone that would pray for you that you could tell everything?
Yeah, come on. Yeah.
Come on. Some of us make calls, but we only tell half the story.
Right.
We don't tell what's really going on. Y'all don't hear what I'm saying. We don't tell it. We tell it after we get caught.
Right.
We tell it after the damage has been done. But we don't call someone that's a real friend. Oh, I don't want to hear what they had. Honey, that's what you need to hear. What is the people that's surrounding around you that's agreeing with your foolishness producing in your life? What is it producing? So you feel better right now, but you feel bad after the consequence comes.
Right.
I would rather hurt a little right now because I don't want to hear what you got to say. I would rather hurt a little right now than the pain of what I'm going to feel like later from bad decisions. From a lack of godly counsel. See, a godly friend gives godly counsel. A godly friend will run the risk of losing you to save you. God, you don't hear what I'm saying. I'm talking about a godly friend. They'll run the risk of telling you that thing that they know you're going to snap and break on them. Y'all don't hear what I'm saying, but I'm going to tell you because I'm your friend. And if I got to lose you to save you, then losing you is worth the price. That's what love is.
My God.
If one person falls, then the other can help, can reach out and help. But someone who falls alone is in real trouble. When you isolate yourself, then you're in trouble. When you cut yourself off from everything God has surrounded you with, to receive love from it, to receive connectivity from, to receive counsel and wisdom from, to receive strength from. When you isolate yourself, then you're in real trouble. Look at the animal kingdom. The lion doesn't hunt the strong herd that stays together. They look for the babies and the sick ones that can't quite keep up with the rest of the herd. My God, See, and that's what I sense in the spirit. Some of you are weak. You don't want to admit you're weak, but you're weak. You're weak. You're struggling. You don't want to admit you're struggling. But you're not with the herd. You're a little bit behind. And the Bible says that our adversary, the devil, goes about as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may. Isolation is the hunting key of the day. To separate you from friends. To separate you from anyone who would look at your life and say, something not right with you today. What's going on? You ain't been right lately. What's up with you? Get out of my business, honey. That's why you in the business you in. Because ain't nobody in it with you with some sense. You're in trouble. But God sends this word today to tell somebody that you might be in trouble, but you can get out if you start looking at it His way. If you'll start letting Him define what a friend looks like. Likewise, two people lying together can keep each other warm. But how can one be warm alone? A person standing alone can be attacked and defeated. My God. But two can stand back to back. I want you just to encourage somebody that you didn't come to church with and look them in the eyes and tell them, I got your back. I got your back. And it's not just words. I got your back. If they attack you, they got to fight me too. If you're going through it, we're going to go through it together. If you in need, if I got a sandwich, I'm cutting it in half. And you come on, y'all don't hear what I'm saying. I got your back. You in a fight, but I put my back up against your back and we'll fight together.
Yeah. 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 Yeah.
They stand back to back and conquer. Having a friend doesn't mean that you'll win every battle, but you'll win more than you lose. God help me. I said you'll win more than you lose when you got the right friend around you. And it says, and three are even better, for a triple braided cord is not easily broken. I believe that the third one is God. Amen. That is the tie that binds us. That's what pulls us together. It's God. I don't have any other reason to be connected to you other than the fact that we serve the same God. But that's enough.
Yes.
So what, we don't eat the same foods and like the same things and watch the same shows? It don't matter. So what, we don't have the same background and the same experience? Maybe you grew up in the hood, maybe I didn't. So what? The tie that binds us is the Spirit of God. And we can learn from one another. We can grow in godliness together. We can support one another. You may not have a man, but you can have a friend. You may not have a wife, but you can have a friend. And God says you can find fulfillment in friendship while you wait. Friendship is fulfilling. Come on, let's get out the bedroom, y'all. Because if the truth be told, you're not longing for a companion. You're longing for... That's what you really want. But you'll find out, honey, and many of you know, if you just pay attention to your life, you can have that and not have a friend. You can have that and they not know or care about you really. Your heart could be aching, but you can't tell them. Come on. Come on. Come on. Your deep secrets, your deepest fears. Yeah, you sleeping together, but you can't tell them. But God can give you a friend that sticks closer than even a brother. Defining friendship God's way. Stand on your feet.
Thank you for listening. We hope this message has enriched your life. For more information, log on to our website, www.thewaycolumbus.com, or email us at thewaycolumbus@gmail.com. And remember, Jesus is the way.